Hello, everyone, and welcome to Nights of Horror, live from Nebraska Wesleyan University. We are so glad that you could join us for what we hope will become an annual event. All month long, Nights of Horror will bring you amazing programming on the theme of horror, not only to get you in the mood for the season, but also to encourage critical engagement with a broad array of themes. Dr. Matthew Jarvis and Professor Juan Jose Castellano Marquez have been working tirelessly to create this spine-tingling event, and I could not be more excited. They even have asked me to present. Given my interest in the creepy and the crawly and a PhD in entomology. So I invite you to tune in nightly and don't forget to check out the website at www.nwunightsofhorror.com to see who or what is next. Greetings all. I am very pleased to welcome Dr. Kendall Phillips to Nights of Horror. Dr. Phillips is a professor of communications at Syracuse University. He has published several books, including A Place of Darkness, The Rhetoric of Horror in Early American Cinema, Controversial Cinema, The Films That Outraged America, and Projected Fears, Horror Films and American Culture. Tonight, Dr. Phillips will be presenting a talk entitled A Certain Tendency in Post-Occupy Cinema, The Purge, The Cabin in the Woods, and Snowpiercer. Welcome, Dr. Kendall Phillips.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Nights of Horror. Tonight, we have Dr. Kendall R. Phillips giving his talk, A Certain Tendency in Post-Occupy Cinema, The Purge, Cabin in the Woods, and Snowpiercer. Welcome, Kendall.
Well, first of all, I want to begin by saying thank you and in a very profound way to Professors Matthew Jarvis and Juan Jose Marquez Castellano for this enormous body of labor. I also want to sort of express gratitude to what is undoubtedly a whole host of invisible workers, probably some IT people, my guess, probably some colleagues, some staff, undoubtedly some family and loved ones who have picked up some burdens or come in to take care of other tasks while you all have been putting together a month of programming. And I also want to give a special thanks to Nebraska Wesleyan University President Dr. Darren Good. I have to say, as an academic working in horror studies, I think most of us wish our chancellor knew that we were working in horror studies, let alone that there was a thing called horror studies, but certainly we wouldn't expect the kind of full embrace that Dr. Good has given to this event. And I will say, he has made me feel a little better about the things crawling around my 100-year-old house, though there were probably maybe a few too many of them. I also just wanna say, and I know the event's not over, like this is, there's still a couple more nights, but I do want to sort of say congratulations to all of you on what has been an incredibly ambitious undertaking. Not just the amount of time, but this mix of artists and writers and filmmakers and public intellectuals and academics. You know, as a person who bounces around the horror community a lot, I do love it and find it vibrant and exciting, but it's also really very separated, right? You know, so you get the writers over in Horror Writers Association, you get the academics like me over in the SCMS, the Horror SIG, you get the blog folks, the podcast folks, and the filmmakers, and everybody's interested in the same thing, but we don't always find ourselves in the same place. So for you all to bring all those folks together is just laudatory and incredible. The only thing I wish is that there was a big Zoom bar, like maybe the basement of Zoom, where we could all get together and have a drink and share some stories. Maybe next time, Matthew, we can pull that off. So on my part, I would say I'm honored and humbled to be here near the end of this event. To be part of what is really an all-star cast of creators and artists and scholars. And particularly as an academic working in and around horror studies, it's humbling to be following so many of the folks whose work has really profoundly influenced my own thinking. I think of Andrew Scahill and Karen Renner, who individually have done tremendous work on Monstrous Children. Robin Means Coleman, I think I was saying this to you earlier, Matthew. You know, when I read horror noir, I just thought, oh, wow, I have had this all wrong. Like, this fundamentally has changed my way of thinking. I wish I had seen this years and years ago. And so I'm just so profoundly impacted by her work and continuing work. And of course, Bernadette Calafell, who is my longtime friend, occasional collaborator, and I should say, co-editor, along with the amazing Marina Levina, for a book series we have on horror and monstrosity studies at the University Press of Mississippi. So all of those academics who are here or maybe watching, if you these ideas become book manuscripts, send them to us in Mississippi. We'd love to take a look at them. In fairness, I'm not entirely sure I belong in such a auspicious group of scholars, and so I'm honored to be invited, but you know, hey, it's still 48 hours till Halloween and we're all here, so what the heck, let's just do this thing. So my talk tonight is part of a bigger project that will, knock on wood, hopefully be a book, hopefully coming out next year with Palgrave Macmillan's series on film and media studies. The book is tentatively titled A Cinema of Hopelessness, The Rhetoric of Rage in 21st Century Popular Culture, if I actually get around to finishing the manuscript. The book project, as a kind of broader piece, asked the question, essentially, how did we get here? And by here, I mean this moment that I think we are all living in, that is so fractious and divided and fraught and filled with bitterness and anger in our political kind of attitude towards the world. I think without fearing that I'm going to provoke any partisan politics, I can say that we all feel deeply divided, that we're filled with suspicion and maybe even hostility towards everyone around us and towards the political, economic, cultural system kind of as a whole. And every day we see people on the right, on the left, and elsewhere openly declaring that the system, whatever that means, the system, has failed, has betrayed us, is no longer viable. So in the book as a whole, not to go on too much about that, what I'm trying to do is explore the circulation, not necessarily of these ideas, but the circulation of these feelings. How did we get to share these feelings of betrayal and rejection and refusal and anger and ultimately rage? And I want to look at the way those might have circulated through popular cinema and popular culture broadly. Part of the book focuses on horror, which is what I'll focus on tonight. I should say other parts of the book move beyond that genre. And so I'm interested in the oddly persistent popularity of films derived from comic books and superheroes. So there's a chapter on Todd Phillips' film, The Joker. There's a chapter on the monstrosity known as the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But it all begins really with the question of horror. So this talk is actually where the project started. And the project started in 2014 when I saw a screening of the very limited release in the US of Bong Joon-ho's Snowpiercer. And after I saw it a second time, I started thinking, boy, this feels familiar. Like somehow this film feels familiar. Now, obviously, if you've seen Snowpiercer, and I'm gonna talk more in detail about it, you know that it does borrow from a lot of pop culture tropes, ranging from Blade Runner to Logan's Run, to Mad Max, Battlestar Galactica. But my sense was that there was a different kind of more recent connection between the way this film felt, or perhaps better invited me to feel, and other films that had come out right around the same period of time. And so in my thinking about Snowpiercer, I began to draw connections, rightly or wrongly, and you all can be the ones to decide, to at least two other films, that I thought these three films represented not only a particular way of feeling, but kind of represented an echo of a moment in history where a lot of people were declaring the system failed and corrupt and inadequate that occurred in and around the Occupy Wall Street movement. So for me, I wanted to think about these films and their relationship to that moment of Occupy Wall Street, not as allegories, not like trying to represent Occupy, but more as how did they ask me to feel about the world, and were there ways in which that was similar to what Occupy had asked? So without further preamble, let us begin. for those of you who don't remember, or maybe too young to remember, Occupy Wall Street began in New York City's Zuccotti Park in September of 2011. And it was immediately focused on the housing crisis of 2008, the financial bailouts of various industries that had happened in 09 and 10. And it was kind of invested in this sense that Wall Street had been bailed out while the rest of the country had been left hanging. But in other ways, Occupy Wall Street was really about a bigger historical period, decades of discontent with the broad social structures of the contemporary global political economy. Michael White, for instance, notes, for a few magical weeks in 2011, the Occupy Wall Street meme spread far beyond Manhattan, from city to city, from financial district to public park. People's encampments sprang up in 941 cities in 82 different countries. And this rapid spread suggests that this was not just about the financial bailout of Wall Street, but was rather, as Tanyang Fang suggests, a kind of explosion of a whole series of accumulated financial crises, economic crises, and social crises that marked capitalism entering the 21st century. Of course, other commentators noted that what was going on in the United States around Wall Street was historically happening around the same time as other uprisings in other parts of the world, notably those in the Middle East and North Africa. Now, I clearly don't want to equate what was happening in Tunisia and Egypt and Lebanon with what was happening in Manhattan, but as Mohamed Bamye says, there was a kind of core similarity across these multiple popular uprisings. The primary one was that in each instance, the movements rejected this idea that the system was necessary. And in each instance, the ruling elites, whether it was the president or folks in other countries, were saying, yes, yes, you're upset, but you know, we can't fix the whole system. And people were all rising up and saying, well, then maybe the system is the problem. Right. So I want to recognize the uniqueness of each of these sites, but I also want to recognize that there was a kind of core sentiment, a kind of feeling that was occupying, if you will, all of these movements. Now, if we pivot back to the United States, Occupy bore a pretty close resemblance to another political movement that occurred actually just a little before Occupy, and that was the Tea Party. Now, some of you may be shaking your head saying, how could the right-leaning Tea Party and Occupy be thought of in the same way? And in many ways, they were very different. But as Arjun Jayadev notes, Occupy was actually thought by a lot of people as a left-wing version of the Tea Party, in that both had a focus of public anger on business and political elites, and both had a sense that something was fundamentally wrong in the broader American system and that fundamental changes were needed to bring about some sense of balance, decency, and democracy. So while clearly they were different in their political ends of the spectrum and the kind of strategy they chose, Tea Party chose to infiltrate into a major political party. Occupy refused to get involved in party politics, refused to have leaders, refused all those sort of traditional movement moments. But they did share a frustration and a sense that something was fundamentally wrong in the status quo of American politics and economics. And with it, both shared a sense of betrayal and outrage. Now, trying to connect all of these disparate movements would be impossible if we try to think of them as movements. Because when we think of social movements, we tend to think of a movement that wants to go from here to here, which is to gain some policy objective or some cultural change. And so the movement wants to move. A better way potentially of thinking about Occupy is to think of it not as a movement, but as a moment. Indeed, no less than WJT Mitchell posits that Occupy could be thought of as a revolutionary moment with all the assorted ambiguities and of the merely a momentary and ephemeral alongside a sense of a momentous turning point. So in Mitchell's view, the dynamics of Occupy, including its refusal to establish leaderships or demands, was really an effort to extend this moment of the renewal of possibility in politics, the possibility that there's something other than the system. My sense is that Occupy represented a kind of momentary rupture in our, not just in the political and economic system, but a rupture in our connection or commitment to that system, and with it, our feeling towards that system. And I want to understand that connection of feeling towards the economic political system and how Occupy ruptured it through popular culture. Now, thinking about Occupy in relation to popular culture kind of makes sense. It did largely come out of the magazine Adbusters. The whole meme of the 99% was clearly a part of pop culture. And of course, anybody who remembers that period remembers the ubiquitous Guy Fawkes mask from Alan Moore's graphic novel, V for Vendetta, and of course, the filmic adaptation. There were also protesters dressing up as zombies to demonstrate the way the system was a giant living dead entity feeding off of us. And of course, there were also lots of representations of Occupy in shows like The Newsroom, Law and Order, South Park, all trying to represent Occupy. My interest, however, is not so much in the allegorical representation or the symbolic representation of Occupy, but more in this idea of its feeling or its attitude, or what I'll call later its affective orientation toward the world. I then came up with this sense that there was something going on in popular cinema after Occupy. And so I came up with this idea that I call post-Occupy cinema that embraces a certain tendency of affect and feeling. And I want to demonstrate that tendency in the three films that, at least for me, were the first that kind of really started to make it clear, these three films that I'll talk about in more depth later this evening. And what I think these films share, I'll talk a little more about them in detail, a little synopsis and a sense of what they are. But what I think Cabin in the Woods from 2012, The Purge 2013, Snowpiercer also 2013, came to the US in 14, what they really share at root is a vision of horror that emanates from a deep system, a sense that the system is evil. And that's, again, a little different than a lot of other attitudes of horror, which see evil as a corruption in the system, or as an enemy infiltrating the system, or often as a threat to the system. For these films, and as I'll suggest later, other films, evil is the system itself. The system itself is evil. So in what follows, because this is an academic paper, I'll have three parts, because that's what we do in academics, we have three parts. First, I want to talk a little about the relationship between affect, pop culture, and horror. Second, if I want to try to think about the echo of the emotional echo of Occupy, I'll start by looking at, okay, well, what did Occupy feel like, or what I'll call the affective structure of Occupy. Then for the majority of the talk at the end, I will focus on these three films and the way I'll suggest that they share a kind of similar structure of feeling. So let's get to horror, because that's why we're here. It's October, woohoo, right? The three films I'm going to suggest all kind of are in or around the dark constellation of horror. Now, undoubtedly, some of the naysayers are at home already chewing their popcorn and shaking their head saying, not Snowpiercer, that's not horror, that's science fiction. But I'll suggest at the very least it's post-apocalyptic dark science fiction. Surely I can get that, right? It's not Star Trek we're talking about here. And I'll quote no less than Stephen Hanke, who clearly needs to be quoted here, who studies the overlap between horror and dark science fiction and points out that while horror and dark science fiction may diverge in terms of narrative and sources, they share in their affective structure that all of these films aim for suspense, shock, and even disgust and horror. So I'm going to hopefully stipulate that I can talk about Cabin, Purge, and Snowpiercer as all occupying something like this broad constellation of horror films. Now, if you'll give me that these are horror films, then it makes sense that these films would have some connection to the broader moment of kind of cultural upheaval, right? Certainly, horror has long been understood to have a connection to cultural moments of upheaval. Surely, it is no small coincidence that the first films formally called horror films emerged in 1931, Dracula and Frankenstein, which were called by Variety in April of 1931, the beginning of the horror cycle. It's also worth remembering that 1931 was one of the worst years of the Great Depression, one of the highest rates of unemployment, bank failure, financial institution failure. And in the midst of all this, the Hoover administration essentially said, we are powerless to do anything about it. It's economics, not politics. So in a moment when the world was literally being turned upside down for most Americans, at least economically and in some ways politically, American audiences were drawn to fantastic tales of the living dead. And somehow these unnatural ghouls kind of resonated with the broader cultural anxieties that were going around at that moment. Now, of course, 1931 is not the only time we've seen moments of cultural upheaval deeply connected with robust, dynamic, innovative moments in production of horror films. The period of late 1960s and 70s, which saw the cultural ruptures of the Vietnam War, the Civil Rights Movement, Watergate, to name only a few, gave birth to what is arguably the second golden age of horror, which between 1968 and 1982, which produced a whole host of films we still talk about today, like Texas Chainsaw, Last House on the Left, Halloween, The Exorcist, Alien, Rosemary's Baby, Friday the 13th. I could go on and on. Certainly that was a period of enormous productivity. At the same time, the culture was engaged in deep sense of division and tumult. Now, if that's true, if horror films do, at least at times, tap into broader moments of cultural upheaval or rupture, then boy howdy, we ought to be entering into a third golden age of horror. And indeed, some have argued, I have actually done as well, that we may be in the third golden age of horror. And while a lot of folks have been triggered to think that way by the wonderful films like Get Out and Us and Hereditary, et cetera, it's worth recalling that even before we had these kind of much more overtly political films, we were having a whole host of films that were at least in some ways connected to the economic turmoil around 2008, namely the many, many haunted house films that appeared. It's worth recalling that in almost every modern haunted house film, the reason the people can't leave is because they have a mortgage they cannot afford. Go back and watch the films, you will find that is indeed correct. Beyond that, as my good friend and former student Leslie Honor, along with her co-authors Scott Varda and Nathan Wilson point out in the Paranormal Activity franchise, that the whole focus of the film and later franchise is around the emphasis on property ownership. And they argue that the films represent and elicit a kind of compulsive repetition at the heart of capitalism, the need to own, to consume property, just as the property is owning and consuming us. And we see that not just with Paranormal Activity, but with Insidious and Conjuring and Oculus and all the other films that represented us being trapped by our houses, which for the folks in 2008 in the mortgage crisis were literally being trapped and consumed by their own houses. Now, films like these, of course, are often read allegorically, and I have done that myself, and I have no objection to the idea of trying to make connections between elements in the film and elements in pop and cultural history and trying to say, oh, look, here's an allegorical relationship. And in some ways, I want to continue that line of thinking, but I want to focus less on the allegorical representationally and more on the relationship emotionally, which is to say, I want to parse out our emotional engagement with the films, the ways in which the films are inviting us to feel about certain things. Now here, the work of Sarah Ahmed becomes useful in thinking about affect, right? This kind of circulation of feeling towards other things. Indeed, in her book, The Promise of Happiness, Ahmed sort of creates this idea that we learn what she calls an affective orientation, right? That some things feel happy, some things feel scary, some things feel sad, and that we habitually inhabit these orientations, and that the way, in part, that we learn these affective orientations, these ways of kind of orienting our feelings towards the world, is through repetitive experience of affective structures. Now, the idea of affective structures should make sense to all of our film folks, because we talk about these ideas a lot. Just a week or so ago, Matt, I saw you, heard you talking with, I can't remember who it was, someone about Serge Eisenstein and that early film theory. And a lot of that was the idea of creating, as Jean Metry says, an affective state, the ways in which the editing process, the film process, creates in the audience an affective state that activates their feeling and in that way creates a kind of state of mind. Or as Brian Lewis calls it, films invite a kind of affective structure of thought. So I want to think then about the ways in which the affective structures of certain texts, here horror films, can be seen as kind of echoes of affective structures of particular moments in cultural history. And as those circulate, they become part of what Ahmed calls an affective economy. So this is all about asking the question, how is it we come as a culture to share feelings? Right? We share feelings because we encounter common cultural texts that invite us to feel a certain way. So Occupy, just to kind of bring this part to a kind of conclusion, for me, Occupy represented a kind of rupture in our normal sense of feelings, a kind of rupture at what I've called elsewhere, the ideological scenes, right? That we had all these kind of recognitions of tensions around politics and economics and culture, and we sort of were able to kind of get over the seams and sort of live with it. But Occupy is a moment where that kind of got ripped open and thrown up in our face. And Occupy, what it really did beyond sort of changing the language of politics or pushing for a particular political or economic agenda, it asked us to feel differently about the broader system, to feel differently about politics, to feel differently about economics. And as I said, the kind of core of this argument is that that structure of feeling, how Occupy asked us to feel, later echoes in these film texts I want to focus on. So to move that direction, then the next question would be, okay, what did Occupy feel like? Well, let's take a look. Now, obviously, something as complicated as the Occupy moment, because remember, I'm not just talking about what happened in Wall Street. I want to talk about this whole moment of rupture. There clearly are lots and lots of feelings. And so undoubtedly, some of the people who were involved in some of these movements felt in all kinds of different ways. What I want to do, boil down by looking at some, you know, participants' comments and a lot of the academics who were involved and talked about it. I want to boil it down to kind of what were the things that made Occupy different? Like, how was it asking us to feel different than any of the other previous kind of social movements designed to reform or change society? I identify what I think are three key kind of orientations that Occupy had that made it a little different, made it at least feel a little different. Those are the evil of the system, the audacity of refusal, and then what I'll call the uncertainty of what remains. So one of the most obvious aspects of Occupy that made it different than any of the other sort of efforts to reform or change the economic political structure in the US or in other places was that it was not asking us to fix a particular thing, but it was asking us to change the entirety. Rinku Sen, for instance, puts it this way, that Occupy didn't focus on the symptoms of inequality, that Occupy was about the system of inequality. And in asking us to shift our focus, Occupy asked us not to think about changing it or rooting out the evil, or even nostalgically going back to the way the system used to be, but rather to think that the whole system essentially had to be burned down to the ground. The whole thing was corrupt, irredeemable. Now, the key for that feeling of the system being irredeemable was that it was also a sense of betrayal, right? Arjun Jayadev points out that the overwhelming sense among protesters in the Occupy movement is that they have been betrayed by what might be called the Horatio Alger myth, that myth that if I just work really hard and do well in school, I can get ahead. But Occupy pointed out that that's not true. Like, for the vast majority of us, we will not get beyond the social economic status of our parents, that we will be trapped at best, and maybe we'll go backwards in many, many instances. And so for the folks involved in looking at Occupy, they were not only asked to see the system as evil, but to recognize that they had been part of the system and that the system had essentially betrayed them. It was, as Mitchell points it, a kind of exposing of the systematic violence that had been concealed under all of this public language about stability, safety, security, progress, right? And this revelation, of course, was directly aimed at the Occupy participants. They had to recognize that they had been part of a system that was irredeemably, horribly corrupt. Now, if the system is irredeemably corrupt, then the only solution is, well, either to just give up and go back and say, fine, I'll get a job, which I guess is what most of them did, or to refuse the system in its totality, which is an audacious suggestion, the audacity of saying, no, right? I will not be part of this system as a whole. Indeed, David Graeber suggests that one of the key philosophical ancestors to Occupy was anarchists, who also refused not only the system, but to recognize the legitimacy of even the political institutions designed to fix the system. So it's not simply a matter of saying, we don't accept the system, but we won't even become part of the process of fixing it, because even the process is part of the problem. It was in essence a way of saying, and part of the reason that Occupy doesn't give leadership, and Occupy didn't have a political agenda or a policy statement, that there's not a lobbying group in Washington, D.C. called Occupy Inc. that's still trying to promote the interest of Occupy. Because Occupy, as a philosophical moment, said, you can't try to reform the system. It must be entirely refused, not partially refused. Now, part of this audacity, of course, of this refusal was not just in the totality of the refusal, but it was in the danger it posed to those who refused it. Deborah Gould, who was heavily involved in a lot of the movement, said that the real issue was that to become part of the Occupy movement was to leave behind the comfort and security that derive from the familiarity of knowing what is going to happen next. So again, you know, on Tuesday, we're all going to vote. Hopefully, go vote. And then within a few days or maybe a couple of weeks, we'll find out the results of the political election. But we kind of know, hopefully, what will happen in that process. Occupy says, refuse the system and you have lost that security. That's why there's audacity in this decision to leave it. Which, of course, leads us to the third, which is if the system is evil, and we have the courage, the bravery, maybe the foolishness to completely refuse the system, the Occupy moment is not going to say what happens next. There's no utopia that they paint for us. There's no nostalgic return. It is simply a moment of uncertainty. And so Occupy, in some ways, as a kind of, again, a kind of philosophy or an affective orientation, asks us to engage in what is essentially, as Nathan Schneider calls it, a kind of apocalyptic thinking. As Schneider argues, what makes an apocalypse is the veil-lifting revelation that the world has definitively and decisively changed, that a new order has been set in motion, even if we don't know what that new order is. And so for Occupy folks, it was a matter of leaping into a post-system world where there was no clarity of what to expect on the other side. It is this that creates it not as an apocalyptic philosophy or feeling, but in some ways as a post-apocalyptic philosophy or feeling. So to sum all this up, Occupy invited participants, and I think not just the people there, but everybody kind of in the culture who was kind of part of witnessing this moment and kind of thinking about it, whether in the US or in other places, it invited us to engage in this kind of wholesale refusal of the cultural, political, economic system with the hopes that such a ridiculously foolish refusal would open space for something entirely different. Now, of course, as noted and any number of critics can point out, one of the reasons that people say Occupy failed is because it didn't have an agenda. And so it kind of essentially could be thought of as petering out. But I want to suggest, rather than thinking of it as petering out as a failed social movement, we recognize the degree to which it unleashed not only different language, and I think we definitely have different language around economics today in America than we did before, but it also unleashed or at least kind of galvanized a certain way of feeling. And as my opening example suggests, I think a lot of us are still feeling that the system is problematic, that we'd be better off getting rid of it, and whatever comes next might be better. I think that structure of feeling has been echoed in a lot of popular films since 2011. I want to focus on the way in which I think that orientation, that affective structure appears in the three films I'm interested in today. And so now we move to the last of my sections, the desire to occupy horror. So in what follows, I want to focus on these three films. These are not the only films, but I think for me at least, these were the three that were most instructive in thinking about how this Occupy affective energy and structure kind of echoed out throughout the culture, and that is Cabin in the Woods, The Purge, and Snowpiercer. Now, to be clear, I'm not suggesting that the films were made in response to Occupy. I have no sense that any of these filmmakers were thinking about Occupy Wall Street. And indeed, Cabin in the Woods was actually filmed and in the can before Occupy happened. What I'd rather suggest is that these films and the audiences attending them picked up on some of these affective energies that were circulating in the culture. Just as I don't think Todd Browning or James Whale made Dracula or Frankenstein saying, aha, we will address the Great Depression. What I'm suggesting is that those affective energies and orientations were circulating in the culture so that both filmmaker and audience had to account for the film text within the broader context of these feelings. So the three films, as I said, I think share a generic root in horror and dark science fiction, but beyond that, they are really quite different. And if you've seen them, that will make this talk a little better, but I will try to give a little synopsis as we go forward so folks feel a little bit like they have an idea of what's going on. Cabin in the Woods is a clever meta-horror film, which initially follows what seems to be the normal conventions of a horror film, stalk and slash. We've got a group of teenagers. They go out to drink and party in a cabin. Undead ghouls appear. But systematically, the film starts to subvert those tropes as the audience and later survivors learn that the entire horrific, monstrous experience has been engineered by a secret government agency who enact this ritual annually to appease ancient evil demon gods and preserve life on Earth. S.T. Joshi said, I feel like I'm calling on Lovecraft's spirit here. So I'm sure the other folks will be remembering those great talks. The Purge, the second of these films, is a lower budget home invasion film set in the future of America, in which social stability is maintained by a 12-hour period, the titular Purge, in which all crime is legal. And I'm not entirely sure we're that far away from this moment, but anyway, I'll leave that aside. The film combines motifs of John Carpenter's assault on Precinct 13 and escape from New York, and attends to a single upper middle class family, the Sandons, who find themselves the target of a gang of vicious young killers who invade their home on this one lawless night. Now, perhaps the most different in tone and style is Bong Joon-ho's Snowpiercer, an adaptation of the allegorical French graphic novel in which life on Earth has been extinguished by a sudden freezing. And the only survivors are those on a seemingly unstoppable passenger train circling endlessly the Earth. The plot of the film follows an uprising by those in the rear of the train, downtrodden individuals who live in abject poverty, who travel, really fight their way forward through increasingly opulent classes of service in an attempt to rectify the social inequality for the passengers. And anyone who's ridden British Rail, you know exactly what this is like. Now, the three films are noticeably different, of course, in plot, in tone, in style, and also reception, right? The Purge was by far the most successful, garnering $34 million on its opening weekend with a total domestic gross of $64 million by the time it was done and spawning a whole series of sequels. Cabin, which was an A-list director, Joss Whedon, was critically acclaimed, but not that successful at the box office, about $42 million, but it did become a kind of cult favorite, and I think everybody in horror spends a lot of time stopping certain scenes of that film to kind of figure out what's going on. Snowpiercer, of course, was the most problematic in its release, thanks to Harvey Weinstein. Like, he has enough sins to account for. He also needs to account for not liking the way Snowpiercer was edited and kind of refusing to give it a mass release. But even in spite of its limited US release, it was hugely successful overseas with $82 million take and has spawned, I think, a good deal of interest in part because of Ho's later Academy Award with Parasite. And indeed, it's been so intriguing that TBS last year launched a television series based partly on the film, partly on the graphic novel. Now, in spite of the fact these films are very different, what I want to suggest over the next few minutes is that they do share this affective structure, that each of them identifies the evil is within the system itself as a whole, that each of them pivots on a moment, sometimes moments, in which the system is refused. And finally, that each film invites the audience to ponder the uncertainty of what can remain after the system is refused. So let's start And again, the next few minutes, I'm going to bounce across the film. So just be comfortable. You'll see the titles. So you'll know where I am. Hopefully my narrative will make some sense. If it doesn't, blame Matt. He's the one who invited me. Cabin actually, interestingly, doesn't begin with the young people. And I remember when I first saw Cabin in the Woods, I literally could hear people saying, I think we're in the wrong movie. Because it doesn't begin with a bunch of young people going to a cabin. It begins with these two bureaucrats, Hadley and Citizen, dressed in white shirts and black ties and engaged in everyday kind of casual office banter. Indeed, as Cabin unfolds, the audience keeps switching in a kind of confusing way, point of view, from the young people who are being terrorized to these civil servants who are working in an underground bunker and eventually we learn are producing and manipulating the horrors that are tormenting the young people. For much of the movie, at least until things go really awry in the third act, the underground bureaucrats are marked not as evil or malevolent, but really kind of charmingly banal, right? Various office workers chat, they flirt, they do kind of office stuff. They hold an office betting pool, one of those scenes everybody pauses to take a look at. Betting pool based on which supernatural terror the young people will choose to be their tormentor. So as the young people are in the basement looking at these various cursed objects that are going to bring some nightmare onto them, the office workers are watching in what is kind of like a college NCAA basketball tournament, like who's going to end up getting the choice of undead redneck zombie family. A similar banality can be seen at the opening scenes of The Purge. In the opening title, we are informed that America has entered into an idyllic future phase with low unemployment and virtually no crime. Gosh, again, this sounds like a campaign promise that's happening right now. All of this is due to the Purge, an annual 12-hour period of lawlessness designed to allow us to release our normal negative violent impulses. The national mantra here on the screen for you is, blessed be the new founding fathers for letting us purge and cleanse our souls. Blessed be America, a nation reborn. And the film actually opens with the Sandin family as they're beginning preparation for the annual purge. And one can note almost all the families are decorating their house in the neighborhood with blue flowers as a kind of patriotic symbol of their support of the annual purge. Now, anybody listening to this talk might say they're beginning to hear philosophical echoes of that great German Jewish philosopher Hannah Arendt and her discussion of the trial of Nazi Adolf Eichmann, in which she pointed out that Eichmann wasn't some horribly evil monster spouting brilliant plans for world domination, but he was actually remarkably boring. And this is the phrase that she came up with, the banality of evil. In her assessment, she pointed out that it was not so much the malevolent ideology, but as she called it, this remoteness from reality, this thoughtlessness, which she says can wreak as much havoc as all the evil instincts taken together. And so in both Cabin and Purge, the overall system is not presented in some evil, completely malevolent way, but is kind of remarkably boring, systematic, bureaucratic, and banal. Now, Snowpiercer presents an even more outlandish, though in some ways no less banal, exploitative system. After an attempt to stop global warming goes horribly wrong, the Earth has been transformed into a frozen wasteland. The only survivors are those living on this enormous locomotive, driven by what occupants refer to as the sacred engine, and circling the frozen planet. The film really begins with the lowest classes, those who live in the rear of the train, and exist in abject poverty and survive only on protein bars made from insects. See, Dr. Good should hear this. I hope he's hearing this talk because he'll be happy about that. As Mason, who's kind of the second in command, the kind of chief steward for the train, explains to those in the back, order is the barrier that holds back the flood of death. We must, all of us on this train of life, remain in our allotted stations. We must each of us occupy our preordained particular position. So each film presents its banal system as necessary for the continuation of life. In Snowpiercer, the system maintains order on the train, and this is presented as the only way for human life to survive on a planet that is no longer inhabitable. In Cabin, we learn eventually that the systematic torture and murder of the young survivors is part of some weird cosmic bargain that keeps the old gods down below and allows human life to continue on the planet. In The Purge, now the threat is not ecological or cosmic, but social. As Jim Sandin, the sort of patriarch of the Sandin family and to some extent our protagonist, explains to his young son Charlie, they're seen on the screen, he says, look, I know this is difficult to understand at your age, but tonight allows people a release for all the hatred and violence and aggression that they keep inside them. You don't remember how bad it was, Charlie, the poverty, all the crime. This night saved our country. Sandin here is really giving voice to the underlying lie of the system, namely that the horrors of the system are needed to prevent even worse fate from befalling us. Now, importantly, in all three films, those who are subjected to this horrible consequence and ordeal are also implicated within it, right? The Sandin family lives a life of comfort and luxury largely because Father Jim Sandin is a successful salesperson for security systems that protect other wealthy families from the violence of the Purge. Indeed, the jealousy of their neighbors, there you see them, plays a pivotal part in later in the film. As the Sandins are being surrounded by these angry young killers who have come to kill them, the neighbors arrive and to save the Sandins. And yet we find that the neighbors aren't actually there to save the Sandins. They just want to murder the Sandins themselves, right? The ultimate example of jealous neighbors. So as you're putting up your Halloween decorations, if your neighbor is looking at you with envy, reconsider. Right? Maybe pull that jack-o'-lantern down. As one of the neighbors explains it, you made so much money off of us, and then you just stuck it in our face. Now, in Snowpiercer, the denizens of the tail section survive not only on the train, but also on the largesse of the forward sections who allow them to eat the insect protein bars. Curtis, played by Chris Evans, Captain America, our film's main protagonist, describes the barbarism of the first months on the train when those in the rear section had no food at all and no water and eventually reverted to cannibalism. The desperate situation was resolved when, as Curtis explains it, Wilford's soldiers brought these protein blocks and we've been eating that shit ever since. Now, the young victims in the Purge don't, or the cabin in the woods, don't really understand what's going on until very near the end, when they finally are explained why all this is happening. After escaping the torment of the titular cabin, the stoner Marty and the final girl Dana find themselves deep within the bowels of the system, where the enormity of their cosmic torment is explained by the system's director. This enormous bargain that the only way the old gods stay below is through this ritual sacrifice and torture. What's happening to you, the director here played by Sigourney Weaver explains, is part of something bigger, something older than anything known. So as with Occupy, the characters within each of these cinematic worlds exist within an elaborate system that maintains survival, and in each film, the protagonists learn the grave and horrifying cost of that system. In The Purge, the Sandins have lived a life of privilege and luxury, but on the fateful night in the film begins, they must face the violent and brutal foundation of their very own privilege. In Snowpiercer, the protagonists embrace the system's promise that it's essential for survival, and for most of the film, they actually fight not to overthrow the train, but just to reform it. And in Cabin, Marty and Dana survive long enough to face the reality of an invisible system that demands their subservience, with the promise of safeguarding them from even more terrifying evils. Now, in Cabin, the system requires a death, and that's Marty's death. The question ultimately at the end of the film is whether to sacrifice him to this system of cosmic order or to allow him to live knowing that you're unleashing cosmic chaos. Confronted with the broader reality of their plight, the director, Sigourney Weaver, urges Dana to kill Marty. Marty, of course, objects, right, as Marty would. Right? If human survival is based on suffering and exploitation, Marty reasons, then humanity might not deserve to survive. Faced with the continuing violence of the system or cosmic obliteration, perhaps obliteration is a better option. Marty contends, maybe that's the way it should be. Maybe it's time for a change. In the end, Dana, our final girl, agrees with Marty, and as they sit awaiting the rise of the old gods, she resigns herself. You may be right. Humanity, maybe it's time to give someone else a chance. Having seen through the facade of the system, Dana chooses to refuse its brutality, even while acknowledging its necessity. Now, Curtis and the small band of rebels eventually do fight their way through various cars of the train in Snowpiercer, all with the idea that they're going to reform and fix the system, only to find themselves in exactly the same dilemma. As Curtis finally confronts the train's designer and engineer, Wilford, here played by Ed Harris, Curtis learns the insidious nature of the system. Curtis's mentor, who had been the one to kind of orchestrate all of this uprising and revolution, we learn, was actually working in conjunction with Wilford to create moments of revolution and anxiety. As Wilford explains it, look, you need to produce a proper balance of anxiety and fear and chaos and horror to keep life going. And if we don't have those things, then we need to invent them. In that sense, the great Curtis Revolution was truly a masterpiece. Faced with the reality that his effort to lead a revolution has actually just been in service of the system he meant to overtake, Curtis and his group must decide whether to accept the inevitability of the exploitation of the system or to reject it. In the end, the cost of the train system proves too great for Curtis and his compatriots. They manage to ignite a bomb that derails the train, resulting in a spectacular crash into the white expanse of the landscape. Now, the Purge doesn't have the kind of apocalyptic cosmic refusal, but there are, I think, in some ways, more poignantly, three crucial moments of refusal. The first is while ensconced in their secure, happy home, the young son, Charlie, here again, chooses to open up the security system and allow an apparently homeless Black man refuge from his tormentors. This simple act of kindness, decency, and charity, of course, sets off the night of terror for the Sandans, as those who are pursuing the homeless man and the plans to kill him and purge themselves eventually surround the house and will ultimately breach its security. The second moment of refusal comes with the father, Jim Sandan, who faces the demands of the violent mob outside his house. The leader, a particularly odious white guy there pictured at the bottom, taunts him. If you don't deliver him by the aforementioned time, we will release the beast on him and on you. And we can enter any home we want, and we will want, as wanting is our will on this fine night. Don't force us to hurt you. We don't want to kill our own. Please, just let us purge. In the end, Jim refuses to surrender the innocent man to this mob outside, and that leads to the home invasion that fills most of the film and threatens his family and ultimately costs Jim Sandan his life. Now, for me, perhaps the most poignant refusal in The Purge is the final one. As noted, the marauders have surrounded the remaining Sandan family with the plans to kill them, but the neighbors arrive just in time to kill off the marauding young people. But then we learn the neighbors are not there to save them, but to kill them themselves. The slaughter, this ritual slaughter, is eventually thwarted by the intervention of that same homeless man, and the family is saved. But the rescuers are left the question, should Mary Sandan kill her neighbors? And the expectation is that she will kill her tormentors, because that is the logic of the Purge. But Mary Sandan refuses. Even as one of her neighbors goads her, oh my God, just do it. Mary Sandan refuses to participate in the system of violent exploitation. We are going to play the rest of this night out, she says, in motherfucking peace. As the siren sounds to signal the end of the annual purge, the neighbors leave. The Sandans are left with their losses and the knowledge that their refusal has done nothing to change the system in which they live. As the nameless homeless man who both imperiled and later saved them leaves, Mary calls out to him, wait, are you going to be okay? Thank you. The stranger replies simply, good luck. Because both the Sandans and the homeless man will need luck as the system that both sustains and imperils them remains. And in 1 year, they will once again face the violence of the Purge. Now, in Cabin, the threatened annihilation of humanity seems to play out. Having thwarted the ritual slaughter, Marty and Dana sit deep within the system as the earth begins to quake. As they consider, what will the old gods look like? A massive hand bursts up through the subterranean chamber, through the cabin, up through the earth, eventually reaching out and wiping the screen blank. Within the diegetic world, then, the refusal of the system and cabin in the woods, in the end, leads to the end, as the ancient hand actually wipes everything out of existence. A similarly dramatic kind of ending, although a slightly different tone of ending, occurs for the refusal of Curtis and the rebels in Snowpiercer. The explosion that derails the train appears to kill most of those on board. The only two we see left alive are two of the rebels, Yona and a young child named Timmy. As the train lies crumpled and burning, Yona and Timmy gear up and step tentatively out into the frozen tundra. As they survey the white expanse that surrounds them, they see up on a nearby ridge a lone polar bear. Yona and Timmy watch as the polar bear pauses to regard them. Now, the ending is ambiguous, but I'll suggest there at least seems to be some hope in the presence of the bear. At the very least, the system's persistent claim that the outside landscape was uninhabitable appears to be incorrect. There may be hope, in other words, outside the brutal system of the train, a new beginning might be possible. Now, to be clear, I have no sense that the makers who made these films were thinking about Occupy or its moment, nor do I have any sense necessarily that audiences went in or walked out thinking, gosh, that reminds me of Occupy. But I do want to suggest that the emotional attitude, what I've called the affective orientation invited by the structure of the film, bears a strong resemblance to what was occupying Occupy. Moreover, I want to suggest that I don't think these films were alone. That's why this is part of a bigger book project. Certainly, we saw similar structures of feeling in the immensely popular young adult novels and films like Hunger Games, Divergent, Maze Runner, and all the others that came galloping along afterwards, with the idea that the system was exploitative and needed to be engaged with some level of refusal and revolution. I'd suggest that similar sentiments were appearing in, of all unlikely places, the superhero films, the Marvel Cinematic Universe. One will recall in Captain America, the Winter Soldier, the film ends with the corrupted government system destroyed, its weapons burned, its secrets revealed to the world. And even more dramatically, in Captain America Civil War, Captain America rejects any idea of the state because it could always be corrupt. His philosophy is clear. The safest hands are our own. Beyond the big screen, I'd like to just quickly point out some small screen examples, right? Now, The Walking Dead might be the ultimate lesson in the dangers of life without a state, and yet, think about the number of story arcs within The Walking Dead that focused on the survivors' refusal of some system of governance, whether that was the governor or Negan or any of the multiple iterations happening in all the sequels, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, just this last year on NBC's Peacock channel, there was an adaptation of Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, which followed a remarkably similar affective structure with the residents of a highly controlled, through chemicals, city called New London, ultimately kind of becoming embroiled in a sudden revolution that literally at the end of the series leaves the city in flaming wreckage and survivors wandering around with no idea where to go. So across popular culture, in horror, in science fiction, in superheroes, on the big screen and on the small screen, there has been an overarching sense of what I'll call the rhetoric of refusal in the air. And I'd suggest that if we spend a few minutes watching the nightly news, there is a sense of the rhetoric of refusal circulating on our streets.
Thanks, sir.
Hello.
Hello. We're on the other side now.
I think I talked for a while. Did I say anything? I don't remember.
I have questions, shockingly.
You always have questions. Just don't start asking me specifics. I'm not. I told you I'm not the encyclopedia guy. That's Murray. Put Murray on. Murray can talk about all the specifics.
Well, that was Joshi. Joshi could tell you where Lovecraft had lunch on Tuesday, August the 28th, 1923 at 1:37 a.m. And
I admire them immensely. I am not one, but I'll do my best. I'll try to hang with you.
That was intense. Okay. I'm trying to figure out exactly where I want to start in all of this. Where do you define this third golden age? What is the signifier for you? Is where I need to start to understand.
It's a good question. You know, it's kind of hard to define an age you're in, because it does seem to become clearer later. Like, I don't know that people in 1968 said, wow, we're beginning a new golden age. I think for me, the moment I started feeling like we were in a golden age was Get Out, which seemed to be one of the first films to kind of capture a spirit and make people start saying. So maybe that is the punctuation point. For me, I think I'm noting kind of precursors again in these films before. Maybe it was Paranormal Activity, maybe The Conjuring. The Haunted House films, I think, were an important bridge into kind of a more politically oriented, invested sense of horror. But I think maybe they were a bridge. You know what I mean? Like they were still pretty tied into earlier tropes and generic ideas. I do think it's telling how incredibly popular and kind of enduring this most recent wave of haunted house films was. Like, you sort of expect a few haunted house films to pop up, but it seemed like a very surprising turn that we would suddenly, like Paranormal Activity, we kind of do Blair Witch again, really, we're gonna do this. And then that it would be followed by The Conjuring and Sinister and Insidious and Oculus, and these would all kind of build these little universes that were very successful. But I suspect later, if I survive long enough to write about the third golden age, or those who will later follow us, I suspect Get Out will be the film that is that marker.
I'm going to give you a different theory.
I like a different theory. Go for it.
I'm going to say 2003.
Okay.
And here's why this is why I'm going to say 2003. I'm straightening my jacket and everything, okay. So you know it's serious. All right. So I'm going to say 2003 as the signifier films that are responding to 9/11.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah.
And I'm going to say also post Abu Ghraib.
So Saw will become our. Yeah, I don't.
Well,
I don't,
I'm going to take up the mantle of torture porn. So I'm going to do Saw, Hostel, and Passion of the Christ.
Sure. Yep.
Because those are the three movies the New York Times cited in that. That's not me saying the Passion of Christ is torture porn. That was what the New York Times said.
Well, my good friend, who's an amazing scholar, and you should have him on sometime, Joshua Gunn, has a fabulous piece that reads Passion of the Christ not just as torture porn, but as porn, with sure. Money shots and the body and the fluids and everything. It's a brilliant reading of the film. But yeah, I think that makes sense. Yeah, 2000 that moment. Yeah.
Let me tell you why though. And to Gunn's point, if you take it through Elaine Scarity, and it, you know, Bodies in Pain, it is torture and porn are the same in Elaine Scarity's view. So I think you need to take them through the idea here of Bataille and Nietzsche.
Sure.
And what I'm going to say here is the other question that WJT Mitchell poses, which of course is the self-titled book, What Do Pictures Want? And I think the answer here is that you need Hostel, Saw, and Passion of the Christ in terms of mediation generationally to get to where you're going.
Yep.
Because I don't think you can have The Purge, for instance, without these three movies.
Yeah, well, let me extend that in a slightly different direction, but I think we're on the same page here. Is, you know, if I think about this from this trope of the system. You know, most of our torture porn are the idea that one is trapped in this kind of eddy, right? So you get trapped by, why am I blanking? What's that? Jigsaw. See, senior moment. I told you, I don't know this stuff. You get trapped by Jigsaw. You get trapped in some foreign country. You get trapped wherever, and you're kind of trapped. But clearly there's an allegory for what we're doing to other people is now being done to us, right? So there's a sense of kind of a reciprocity of trauma. Transition that into the haunted house films. And again, I think one of the reasons the haunted house films of that period are so surprising is who would think that following torture porn, we'd go to spooky houses, right? I mean, that seems like a really abrupt turn. But to follow the thought before you jump in with lots of good explanations, that's about the system and the reciprocity and the trauma we give coming back to us. Then haunted house films are about us being trapped in the systems we've created. Like, we are trapped in the system that was meant to be familiar, but is now unfamiliar, which of course is the core of most Gothic treatments of haunted house films. They're uncanny because this is my house, but because of something, suddenly, you know, my coat looks different. That looks different. It all feels uncomfortable. And if I follow that logic, this reciprocity of systemic trauma trapped in the system, then my argument makes kind of a logical next step. The system as a whole may be wrong.
Sure. The one thing I would add to this, though, is you have to remember the trailer for Hostel. And the trailer for Hostel went through the economics of torturing people. And it concluded with the line, "American, that will cost you."
Of course. Yeah. No, absolutely. I mean, I've always thought, I've taught Hostel many times. It's one of the few films I always say, like, this is going to get a little uncomfortable. not that it's that pretty good, the graphic. I actually find the sexual misogyny, like, more uncomfortable. The slashing of the eye, like the cutting of the eyeball and stuff. I do that for breakfast. But all the, like, sex and that makes me uncomfortable. I'm a Baptist from Texas. Like, that makes me uncomfortable.
I showed Unshin Andalu to students not too unrecently, and they freaked out over the eye being cut.
Oh, come on. Get over it.
Almost 100 years, 91 years old, and it still freaks students out.
Kids today, what are you going to do?
I know. Then I show them the start of Persona, and they really lose their minds.
Every year I teach horror, the students always go, like, this isn't that scary, and I say, don't tempt me. I will traumatize you, little monsters. But I
pull out your Cannibal Holocaust copy.
There you go. Come on, let's go French New Extremism, and we'll all feel really important. I think you're exactly right. I think there is a sense in which that period of torture porn films are, especially, I think you're right, after 9/11, after the first phase or the first few years of the ongoing perpetual war on terror, you get that deeply invested kind of American sensibility. I think what happens maybe with the haunted house films and other is that diffuses out. So it's not so much national identity, but becomes a less nation-specific sense of identity. Because, you know, haunted house can be anywhere. Mm-hmm. We certainly saw kind of variations on that with haunted media, et cetera, et cetera. I don't disagree. I do think in some ways all of this are echoes of the grief of 9/11, but I think those echoes change as they move mm-hmm. through cultural history. And I'm trying to identify something a little after 9/11 that I think was a different permutation of that feeling of grief and betrayal and shock. It all gets turned a little bit, I think, in that period around 2011. At least that's the argument.
Sure. No, I think for your argument, that's correct. I'm interested in when this golden age is occurring, because, you know, I actually am not a Blumhouse fan.
Sure. Yeah.
Which I've said several times over the course of this month, so I probably will never have any of them on here because they won't want to, because I'm not a fan. But I don't care for that set of horror films. I've watched them because I feel like I need to. But I also, it's not really a purist thing, but I am of the school where I think a horror movie needs to be rated R.
Now, come on.
I know.
Poltergeist, come on, that was a good film. Toby,
it is. There's always an exception, but, you know, for the most part, I think that good horror films are usually rated R from my...
I don't disagree. I mean, I don't know that I feel that way, but I definitely feel they need to be shocking. And I do think Blumhouse can get a little paint by numbers, and that's enjoyable. And again, that's part of what audiences can be attracted to, like the sort of repetition of things. But I do feel like that burns itself out pretty quickly. And that's why, you know, you kind of need these moments where somebody takes the haunted house film, which I think is, you know, films like Hereditary and others mm-hmm. kind of took those tropes and like really twisted them in ways that made people uncomfortable again, which is kind of what horror does.
It's interesting. I mean, you know, thinking about haunted house films too, of course my favorite is Ghost Watchers, which doesn't fit this talk at all, but you know, I was thinking more recently when you were talking about of recent ones is the found footage, the first two Hell House LLCs I think are really interesting in that vein, and they follow the same thing in terms of like the economic collapse of a younger person's life, and he gets mocked by the demon for doing it, right? Like, you put your own money into the company.
Yeah.
So you've got that generational argument right there, right?
Yeah, I feel like all of our demons have a direct line to our credit score somehow, and that's part of why everything's the way it is now. But no, I mean, I do think that, you know, the The root of the haunted house film, really going back, has always been economics. And if you go back even into, you know, the silent era and the aughts and the teens, you see, so one of the things, when the last project I did was about silent era horror films. And one of the really remarkably recurring themes of haunted house films in that period, like 06, 07 to 10 or so, were about real estate. Now, inevitably, in those periods, especially 1910 on, there wasn't really a ghost. It was like Scooby-Doo. We find out that it's, you know, Mr. Drucker wants to get the land, so he pretends to be a ghost to scare people off. But that idea of somehow ghosts and frightening tied into a real estate bargain has really deep roots. And I think it is tied into some aspect of property ownership. Like, I mean, if we're haunted by someone else's house, we leave, right? Or, you know, even the haunted hotel, the only way the haunted hotel works in like Shining or
1408.
No, the two, Shining is the one, but the one with John Cusack. And
then room 1408.
Thank you. This is why you're here. I'm glad. I need someone to do the, at my students, I say Google that. I don't remember, but each of those haunted house hotels only work because you're trapped, right? You're either trapped by the weather or you're trapped, like in John Cusack, you literally can't get out of the room because it holds you.
You've now put the Carpenters in my head from that movie.
Oh, Matt, we've only just begun.
Exactly. Just over and over. The Groundhog Day horror film. Yeah. All right. So Snowpiercer, because I hadn't seen this until you said you were going to talk about this, and then I watched it, and I had two thoughts while you were talking. I'd already had the one thought before your talk, of course. When you're talking, I started to think more about Soylent Green.
Yep.
But then I went farther back when I was first thinking about it, and I was actually thinking about the story of the Raft of the Medusa, which is a real story.
No, this I don't know.
You
always get everybody on something. You got me. There you go, Matt. There's your one.
All right. So in 1816. So in 1816, you had, after the fall of Napoleon, right, and you had Louis XVIII restored to the throne, you had French colonization return, and you had a series of ships sent to West Africa, to Senegal, to colonize Senegal. And the Medusa was one of these ships. Now, the captain of the ship was a purely political appointee, and he had never really captained a ship. It's almost becoming a Gilbert and Sullivan song at this point. And so he basically stopped. See, he got that one. Most people will not get that joke. So he stops basically by Tortuga, Pirates of the Caribbean fame almost, because the diaries of the wealthy people, the colonists, say we could see the brands on their arms in order to crew up the ship. Now, he's completely incompetent, but he does recognize politically that if I get there first, that's impressive. So he manages to run the ship aground, right? And it begins to take on water. And it becomes rather funny because, you know, you normally think women and children first, but in his case, it's captains and their matched luggage first. And so they build a raft out of the deck of the ship, and they put 149 people, 148 men and one pregnant woman, on the raft. And, you know, it doesn't go well. And by 10 days in, there are only 15 people left because there have been so many riots aboard the raft, and they've resorted to cannibalism and all those things. And of course, the rich people are like, you know, stalling them off of towing them in the lifeboats and things. And because, you know, history is funnier than true fiction, they're saved by the Argus, which of course is the Greek creature named with a thousand eyes. And they think when they get back to France, oh, we're going to be heroes. But they're like, how did you survive again? But it's the same like idea in Snowpiercer, I feel like. You know, they're in the back of the train being towed along, and they're just like, I don't know.
Or like Titanic, where it was the lower decks that are all getting killed off because they're the ones closest to the water and everybody else gets out first. No, I think Snowpiercer is a really brilliant film, and I think it does capture a lot of this this particular moment and a kind of stark reality, I think, that all of us acknowledge, that even in the system we are in today, depending on your socioeconomic status and to a large extent the color of your skin, determines whether that cop pulling you over is going to give you a warning or shoot you in the face. And I think we know this. And I don't think that's, I don't mean to be political. And I know I'm in New York and you're in Nebraska, so we probably live in different worlds to some extent, but we know this. And I think anybody doesn't know this. I think everybody knows that if I get COVID, I'm lucky if I get to the doctor. And if certain people get COVID, they get, you know, a doctor flying them out to experimental drugs and every possible treatment. We know this is the system. We just keep thinking, well, that's the only system. Mm-hmm. Just like the people on the raft thought, well, there's no other way, right? They're only on the raft. Or the people in the train think there's only one train. And I think the key to all these films and this cultural moment is people saying, what I later in the book call the fantasy of refusal. And the fantasy of refusal is very attractive, but of course it's also a fantasy. I mean, I wish I could walk out and just snap my fingers and the current system of racial exploitation and colonialism and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, environmental degradation, you name it, would just go away because I don't want it there anymore. But I think somewhere, you know, in the real politics, somewhere between the fantasy of refusal and the endless kind of acceptance of the system, there's got to be some in between. But cinema tends to like fantasies. And so we get lots of fantasies of refusal, either in the example of Curtis and the folks in Snowpiercer, or Dana and Marty, or the Sandins in The Purge, or the endless sort of films about, you know, men taking up guns to fight back against their oppressors. These are all kind of fantasies of refusal. And that I think we've got to try to understand those fantasies better.
Sure. It's interesting. I mean, I want to stick on Snowpiercer for a minute because it's your strongest one about class. Obviously, I mean, because they're literally in different classes of carriage. It made me think of two other films as well. Made me think of High Rise, of course.
For sure.
Where, you know, your social rank depends what dictates what floor you live on. And of course, like it's the fish, the head rots first, right? And the corruption sinks down. In that film, which has a different Marvel character in it, right? It has Tom Hiddleston, who is Loki.
The J.G. Ballard novel, which is even weirder than if anything weirder than the movie, the book is even weirder than that. But no, I think it's a great allegory. I've got another one, but what is your other one? What's your
Mayhem?
Story? Oh yeah. The one I was thinking was and I forget. You'll have someone have to look this up. This is where if I had people around, I'd say Google this. There's a film that came out. I want to say it's a Spanish film called Platform. This was, I think it was on Netflix, but I'm going to say it's Spanish, but if I'm wrong, forgive me, I'm old. But Platform is people trapped in a prison where the only food they get is this one big plate of table of food that lowers. And so the people on the top get, you know, a pretty nice table full of meats and cheeses and fruits. But the further down it goes, the less is left. And so it's another like really pound you in the face allegory of this broader global system of inequality. Now, I liked Platform. It felt even a little more allegorical than Snowpiercer, though Snowpiercer is pretty hit you in the face.
Also is Parasite.
Yeah, exactly. So as is Parasite, right? And I think that other film of Bong Joon-ho is also amazing. So yeah, I think there are a lot of filmmakers kind of grappling with this sense of systemic social inequality, both, you know, within a nation, but even worse when we look at it globally. And I feel like at least some of the energy of those cinematic critiques are coming out of that Occupy moment. And that's why I think it's important not to think of it as Occupy Wall Street as this one particular thing, but the same conversation was happening on the right and the left. It was happening in DC and Minneapolis and Chicago and Los Angeles and in Tunisia and in Egypt and in Britain. I mean, I think a lot of the post-2011 political movements, rising populism, nationalism, Brexit, the election of Donald Trump in the US, all I think can kind of have some vestige of that kind of rupture moment that was going on in and around 2011. And I think we're seeing it in a lot of great films.
No, absolutely. I mean, the one in your argument that I can't really figure out exactly how to associate with class, except for, you know, everyone's bourgeois in it, is Cabin in the Woods.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I don't know that there's a specific class critique. I think Whedon et al. tried to do a very explicit job of choosing, you know, the very stereotypical middle class college students. We even get a character of color, so we've got our check that box. I think part of the reason that you don't get the class critique is because Cabin has another project at work, and that's the meta fiction part.
Absolutely.
And so you can't, it'd be hard to play meta fiction with class because horror, at least that style of horror, doesn't overtly play with class. There are lots of horror.
Well, it does because they're all college students. So you had the framing device initially where you could have actually inserted it around college and its persistence of class, you know, as two people who work at universities.
Well, I think the genre of the kind of stalk and slash film that does play class are the kind of what, and I'm blanking on someone's name, so forgive me, but one of my great friends and colleagues whose name I'm forgetting calls hillbilly horror. And that is all the films set, you know, either, you know, the Friday the 13th, where you always had these sort of down at heel rednecks, like where I grew up with my family members living in and around Crystal Lake, telling
it's got a death curse. Yeah,
you're telling you kids, get out of there. That's not for you. And you do have a little of that in Cabin, but the meta fiction part kind of erases that because
He's like a Lovecraftian cultist. Right.
Exactly. Because he really believes it and wants to know if he's on speakerphone.
Uh-huh.
Am I on speakerphone?
I mean, you technically are.
Oh my god, I was it's been a long month for Matt. Everybody be patient. He's getting giddy. He sees 2 days left before he has a day off.
So. Well, you've forgotten that you're gonna be back on Sunday that fast.
And you don't get a day off. That's true.
I don't get a day off. So, I mean, we're not stopping here, you know.
It's like Snowpiercer. The sacred engine keeps going.
So, for those of you who don't remember, Nights of Horror is continuing every Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, 7 p.m. Central Time. And Kendall has actually agreed to come back for the inaugural one with Karen Renner and perhaps another surprise guest. And we're going to examine Halloween from 1978.
Which will be great. And remember, as much as I may be annoying, Karen is really brilliant and lovely. So she will more than make up. She and Matt will make up for my old man babbling in the corner. They'll just put a blanket on me and I'll fall asleep. Don't worry.
Speaking of annoying, the most annoying character in all of horror, who is it?
Again, the names are getting me.
Hold on, let me write it down. Let me write my answer down to see if
we're your answer down. And I'm Oh, I'm gonna have to explain it. You'll give me the name because I'm so embarrassed. I know this. It's the brother from Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the one in the wheelchair.
Franklin. This is what I wrote down.
Funny. This is what happens when you're old. I kept wanting to say Murray because what I'm working on now is this chapter about Joker, and he goes on the Murray Franklin show, and all my brain would say is Murray because I was trying to come up with Franklin. This is what old age does to you, folks. Don't do it. No, Franklin, Sally. Right. I mean, honestly, as a kid who grew up in Texas, most of my relatives are that film is not far from true.
Whenever I share that in class, students cheer when he gets chainsawed in the face.
It is sad, but true. As much as we don't want people to have a chainsaw or their arm cut off. Boy, it did feel a little bit satisfying. So,
yeah, I don't even know what kind of role he fills in terms of a horror movie or even like. If you think about horror in terms of like Greek tragedy, I don't know what role he fills at all.
No. I think his inclusion and his murder is part of what makes Texas Chainsaw such a, I've always said, I think for me at least, this is controversial and people probably would disagree, but for me, it is pound for pound the best American horror film ever made, partly because it is kind of inexplicably shocking and disturbing. And I'm not saying it's the scariest, I'm not saying it's the most violent because obviously there's actually not a lot of violence. It's all implied. But I think it takes turns that even now feel wrong. And I love the degree to which Texas Chainsaw always feels a little bit wrong.
We have a giant wasp flying around in here. That's why I was starting.
Wasp woman, what did you think was going to happen?
I know. Well, you know, yesterday the president said he was... President Goodsey was getting ready with his Wasp Man outfit. So.
Good thing you didn't show arachnophobia. You'd be surrounded by spiders. Yeah.
Well, yeah. All right. Let's a couple more questions for you here. I was thinking to, in terms of like maybe coining a term here, if you think about the sociological implications of horror in these different time periods, right, which is how we kind of think about them divided. Robin in her book Horror Noir, right, does it decade by decade in terms of like how she susses it out. But when you're talking, I was thinking, to borrow Foucault's phrase, of the episteme.
Yeah.
I was thinking the episteme of horror are getting more and more narrow. I can't speak anymore. I can't blame it on an echo and hearing myself tonight either is the bad thing. But these episteme are getting more and more narrow.
Yeah. No, you did a great job with that echoing thing. I would have just turned, if it was me, I'd be like, we're done. Thank good. You just talk to people, but you were a real trooper. No, I think it is narrowing. And I think maybe part of the reason is that there's more accumulated baggage, right? Every decade and generation that goes on, and particularly with the persistence of the media culture, so that, you know, someone like Jordan Peele making Get Out or Us is carrying with them this massive archive of horror, and a wider range of that. And I think this is one of the great things that Robin talks about, and is certainly in the documentary, the degree to which kind of contemporary Black filmmakers are looking not just to the history of horror, but to the history of Black horror. Like, they're able to kind of take those tropes and ideas and subvert them and change them. And I think the in a weird way, the richer the archive gets, the more, you know, kind of limited the field of play is. Although I still have faith that someone comes along and shifts things around.
Well, you also have the interesting condition of massive, massive cultural nostalgia in the time period you're interested in for the 1980s.
Sure.
Right? I mean, not just Stranger Things, right? House of the Devil is another good example, I feel like, for this 80s nostalgia that's re-emergent. And I mean, even sort of like tomorrow night, we have David Weiner on, who looks at the entirety of the 80s. So why now are we so focused on 80s horror all of a sudden, and a return to 80s horror?
It's a good question. I suspect David will have a better answer than I will. I mean, I will say, I think part of it is generational thing, that those of us who grew up in the 80s are now at a point where we have the money to produce things and make things happen. I suspect there's also kind of a return, if you think about the 80s, the 80s followed the 70s. Thank you, there's my math for the evening. But the 70s, you know, that period of the second golden age was partly driven by this deep, deep cultural chaos. That was, you know, all that 68 to 70, 74 and on into it. And then that's part of the reason the second golden age, at least I argue, ends in 1982 with the kind of horrible public reception to John Carpenter's The Thing. Because by 1982 and Reagan, people didn't want graphic, nihilistic, horrible, Lovecraftian horror. They wanted E.T., right? They wanted Phone Home and Elliot and all that sort of stuff. And I think now there's a kind of nostalgia for that clarity, and in some ways that paternal clarity, because whatever you thought of Reagan, and as a kid who grew up in that period, I have lots of thoughts about Ronald Reagan. There was a sense of him as a kind of father figure. And even the campaign in 1980 featuring that, the focusing on that message is, you know, it's a new dawn in America. And again, a new dawn in America is a similar, albeit slightly different, rhetorical move than make America great again, which is to go back to that new dawn, right? You know, we want to go back to that. So I feel like the whole of the culture is looking back to part of the culture is looking back and wanting a simplicity, a clarity, and for some reason, nostalgia is making us think that the 80s were that time. I can say, as a person who was living in the 80s, growing up at that time, it was not a simple, optimistic, happy time, but now we look back and we want, you know, a strong president, a strong national defense, a strong sense of nation, all that stuff that we now look back to the 80s, a strong economy, et cetera, et cetera. But of course, that's what American Psycho was criticizing. So. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I think it was Bernadette, too, who made the fluctuation point that there's concurrently a nostalgia for the 50s.
Which is another period where, you know, there was clarity. It was us versus them, the Soviets. And we had, you know, we all liked Ike and we knew what the American system stood for. So it's almost as if there's more clarity in times of, this Cold War period, right? There's clarity in the good and the bad. It's harder to have clarity in, say, Vietnam, where it's a much more nebulous enemy and really an enemy we have to construct. And the same, I think, was true with the War on Terror, where we kind of culturally had to construct this enemy out of something. Like, I mean, there wasn't a clear enemy in the way there was with the Soviet Union, or back in the 40s, there was a clear enemy with Nazi Germany and Italy. There was a clear ideological, geographic enemy. Once you get to more nebulous conflicts like the Vietnam conflict or the War on Terror, you suddenly have that lack of clarity, and you kind of pine for those days when the world was black and white, us, them, dead kept us safe, the enemy was at bay. That felt like the 50s, that felt like the 80s. And I think maybe right now that's why people are wanting to return to that kind of clarity.
Perhaps, I mean, it's interesting. And I think, and at least in my mind, it's why the horror is so American-centric in its own way. At least I find it to be. I mean, The Purge is absolutely American-centric. Cabin in the Woods, obviously, you could displace that into any culture almost, but it does have a feel to it of a more like an office space meta quality to it, which again is borrowed from Britain in terms of its construct. But I see in terms of a lot of horror it being a specificity to America of late.
I think that's true for American horror. And in fairness, that's what I work in, because I always say to people, I appreciate other cultures. I just don't understand my own yet. And if I ever figure out my own culture, I'll try to figure out somebody else's. I do think though, and this is where, you know, I think what's great that's happening both filmically and in terms of academics is that this is, I guess, I feel like a really golden age also for international horror. So over the last decades or so, we certainly had the Korean, the K-horror and the J-horror. We had French New Extremism. But right now, you know, there's some really amazing films coming out of Latin America, coming out of the Middle East, which is an area that probably a lot of us did not think would produce horror. Some coming out of Africa and the Caribbean, out of Indonesia and other places. Now, a lot of that, interestingly, seems to be playing with American tropes in different ways. And I only say seems because as a purely American-centric scholar, I don't fully understand what's happening. And I expect the same is true for Snowpiercer. Although I always felt, to me, Snowpiercer feels like one of a handful of films that feel more cosmopolitan in the sense of really engaging a much wider global culture rather than just kind of being very specific. But I will say, if I can, there are certain films I always want to champion. So if people haven't seen it, if you haven't seen this, Matt, go see this. There's an amazing horror film out of Mexico by Isa Lopez called Tigers Are Not Afraid. And that, I think, is a great example of some of the tropes of American horror and some of the things we've been talking about, the system, who gets left behind, what the system is haunted by, et cetera, but told from a very interestingly different cultural perspective. I won't pretend to understand it, but I sure appreciate seeing it in a fresh new lens.
Okay. Very good. Do you have a... What horror movie are you looking forward to? Robin gave us the trailer for 2021's Candyman last night.
I would actually say Candyman was one of the films that really hurt me that I wouldn't get to see for a while.
Okay.
That was one I really thought, I think suddenly I'm blanking on anything but that, because I remember, hearing about it and hearing about the woman who's the, I'm blanking on her name, Nia, and I'm like, Costa Da Costa, do you remember there?
I think that's
director's
right.
Director's name? Sorry.
I think Da Costa is right.
That seems so interesting. I read interviews, like that first trailer which I think borrows similar motifs visually from like the artist Karen Walker and others, that use of the shadow figures was so like, wow, this feels like they're really going to knock it out of the park. And then to be, to not see it. So I'm going to agree with Robin.
Okay. So two votes for Candyman 2000 remake 2021.
What were the other votes? I'm blanking on.
I mean, most people haven't got. Most people don't know what's coming out. Like, we're sort of in a You know, we just got the teaser trailer for Halloween Kills today.
I saw that. Yeah, that I will see, but didn't rate my pop too much. And I think the other thing that's interesting is the number of films that I was kind of looking forward to that are now kind of coming out through Shudder. And Shudder, I think, is doing a pretty bang up job of getting some really great stuff. I love the stuff coming out of a company called Spectravision. That's actually headed by one of my former students, who's Lisa Walk, who's awesome. Yay, Lisa. But Spectravision is the one that did Daniel Isn't Real, Mandy, The Color Out of Outer Space, a bunch of other of those sort of films. And I, you know, I think those are really great, interesting, provocative films that probably aren't going to occupy a lot of space at most of our multiplexes because they're a little too weird. But I love that we've got Shudder and Netflix and Amazon and all these places to find this more niche kind of programming.
Yeah, Mandy's great. Mandy's a great one.
Amazing, right? You know, you can't go wrong. And if people like Mandy and you want something even weirder, go track down The Greasy Strangler.
I was at the premiere of The Greasy Strangler.
I saw it at Sundance. Did you see it at Sundance?
I saw it in LA.
Oh, okay.
And
I saw it at Sundance and I was so annoyed because at Sundance, everyone's logged off, no one cares at this point, but Sundance, the must-have item that year were these pink snow toboggan things with Greasy Strangler written on them, and everybody wanted one of these, people going to the premiere. And I remember texting my former student Lisa saying, hey, I'm here, boy, those hats are great, I'd love to have one. And she said, yeah, good luck. I mean, it was like, but I'm your former professor, you're supposed to give me. But yeah, I mean, I think I love the fact, and I think this is part of what's contributing to this, if there is a third golden age, is not just that there are these
films. It's The Greasy Strangler.
That will be the apex. No, it's not just that you're getting these films like Get Out or Us or Conjuring or Saw or Hostel that are really hitting mass audience. I think that's crucial. But we're also finding, just like in the 80s when you had this sudden explosion of horror because of VHS, the streaming services are creating another moment like that, where you're getting films circulating that would have never, ever been anywhere. That's what you had in the 60s when the studio system fell apart and suddenly independent movie theaters were just bringing, you know, people forget Night of the Living Dead was first put out as a double feature matinee, right? It was dumped out in front of kids because they're like, Night of the Living Dead must be a, you know, goofy alien movie. We'll put it in there. So that period of the 60s was created in part by suddenly all these theaters that didn't have a guaranteed studio funnel, studios weren't making as many movies and they needed stuff. So people said, sure, we can make a horror movie in Pittsburgh, what the heck? Same is true in the 80s where you suddenly had the VHS, you had like Full Moon Productions and all those other companies creating the craziest, weirdest, low budget horror films, Puppet Master and Doll Man and Killer Toys and all this kind of demonic toys and all that kind of crazy stuff. And now with the streaming services, we're seeing that kind of productivity again. So it's a great period for being a fan of horror, and it's a great period to have an incredibly smart, intelligent, great platform like Knights of Horror and the amazing Matt Jarvis to lead us. So thank you for being part of the third golden age of horror.
Thank you. I do have, I should end it there, but I can't because I have to ask you this one last question. I have to do it. Juan is like looking at me like I lost my mind, but I want to get it on the thing because it affects what you were saying. And I have to have the footnote here. Is Darren Aronofsky horror?
Yes.
Do you see what I'm saying in terms
of like? I mean, I think absolutely, and it's interesting. You know, again, not to pivot back to what I'm doing now, but I can't help it because that's what I'm doing now. You know, Todd Phillips' Joker. I actually don't argue it's primarily a horror film, but it is deeply invested in the generic tropes, and I think the same is true with Aronofsky and the use of bodies. And the use of trauma to bodies and psychological trauma driven out through the body. This is, I think, you know, these are folks who were raised in the waters of that second golden age of horror. And so that is their vision of trauma. Their vision of trauma, which I think is what a lot of cinema is about, either exploring trauma or trying to stitch it back up after it's happened. I think horror has become a language that a lot of filmmakers and a lot of audiences understand and are drawn to. And that's, I think, part of what we're seeing now.
Well, I'm not going to go fishing for more compliments from the great Kendall Phillips here.
Instead, that's it. You got it.
It's recorded. I can just play it back. It's fine. I invite you out there to tune in tomorrow night. We have director David Weiner, who will be discussing his film and its sequel, In Search of Darkness, and In Search of Darkness Part 2. So if you're an 80s horror nerd, or if you've been with us this long, please tune in. Until then, stay spooky. Button for punishment. I can't end on praise.
Oh, come on. I hit it. Come on.
You did. Juan is rolling his eyes at me, but he can't take a compliment either. So
I hit my mark. I said my line. Snap.
It was great.
Hey, if you could put up with me for an hour and 43 minutes, you deserve, you know, I don't know, probably Prozac or a skip. even my dog would this long. My dog literally left about 20 minutes ago going, I'm done listening to you. Quit your babbling. I'm going to go play with a toy.